Everything is grist for the mill here. We can practice stepping into the light like that. You see? Even if only metaphorically like this. We choose a new idea. Unconditional love overlays everything. You see? We're still here, but we are now experiencing the overlay instead of trauma. There's no trauma in the overlay. There's no trauma in reality. Prime Creator did not create any laws, any power that could bring about any trauma whatsoever. Okay, only in hypothetical scenarios does there seem to be trauma. So we can shift, choose a new idea, and experience that trauma-free experience. Completely free of trauma. Of course, we have trained ourselves to believe that somehow trauma is going to result in some great benefit to us. So we're afraid to choose the way like this, thinking we're going to miss out on that benefit. All right, just have to point this out. It's pretty tough to deal with this from the standpoint of concepts, because concepts are based on belief, and belief is entirely in the tank for trauma. However, you can utilize concepts and belief, utilize it to help you focus on choosing a new idea. But it's difficult. It's very difficult. So we have to, every day you have to say, okay, I can do it. I'm going to do it. Today is the day that I'm going to choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be Prime Creator, and I am going to experience unconditional love like that. See? Every day, you have to make that day seem like, you know, this is the day. This is the day. And realize that you have this belief system that's 100% against you. It's 100% opposed to choosing a new idea. 100% opposed. But it's just a belief system that's opposed. It's not reality that's opposed. So the thing to do is to see that it is a belief system and not reality. And then the opposition will begin to, you feel less. So the problem is we think the belief system is reality, but it's not. It's not reality at all. It's simply a belief system. And we are greater than the belief system. We have a true authority to choose a new idea. The belief system has no authority to choose a new idea. It can only continue to believe in itself. So we can choose a new idea, and just like that, you get this perfect peace, perfect freedom from trauma. And each day we can try to do it, and if we don't succeed, you know, we get back here into the trauma. What you have to do is you have to try again, try to clarify more, lessen the fear, and then again make another effort to shift, choose a new idea. Not even a shift, just choose a new idea. Now, what we're doing here is we're examining the obstacles to this, which is super helpful. Another obstacle needs to be looked at. We haven't quite looked at it yet, and that is pity, self-pity. I think this is the strongest rope to grab a hold of, is to let go of pity. So let us approach that in this video as best we can. You know, it's not always smooth and easy. It is very difficult in this world to choose a new idea, to be here and experience unconditional love instead of trauma. Very difficult. It's also extremely difficult to convince others that this is the right thing to do, because you're speaking through the filter of belief. And again, there's no belief in reality. There's only belief in this hypothetical scenario we've chosen to try and be Prime Creator. And belief believes in itself, so it's inherently, its purpose is to achieve its agenda. So when you're speaking through the filter of belief, it's very, very difficult to help anyone here in this world. And when people come into this world, when we come into this world and want to help, let's say we know the truth, it doesn't really reach people. It doesn't seem to reach anybody. And then the feeling is, how can we really help out? What can we do? What can we add that something's missing? And what the temptation is to go into what's called self-pity and ask other people to pity you as a truth teller, to pity your ineffectual efforts. And you show them, look how sad I am, look how depressed I am, because no one will listen, I'm not helping anybody, and it's ruining my life. And so you let your life be ruined by this, and you appeal using pity. You want people to pity you, and therefore they will make better efforts to understand what you're saying. That is the trap that this world lays, is to go into a condition of just being completely wiped out by ineffectualness, and then hoping that the pity of the world will be the power, that will be the factor that will get them motivated to understand truth. One has to push away that pity, has to say no. Sure, it's difficult, but I can still do it. I can still be a witness here to truth. Now, teaching others, that's a slightly different thing. Okay, but now I want to share with you a way to push away this self-pity so you don't have to keep suffering. You don't have to suffer in order to try and appeal to people feeling pity, taking pity on you, you know? Because in this world, we know that often those who appeal to our pity get response. If we're in such a pitiful condition, we hope that others will respond. Well, it's very possible for the spiritual teachers in this world to go into a pitiful condition, hoping that that'll get people to respond to what they're showing, where to search for the truth. Here's a little story. Let's say there's a deep, deep dark forest, very dark forest. And there's a group of people living in that forest. They've been living there for a long time. And one day, someone comes along in the forest, along some dark trail, and comes into the village there, and they're full of radiant light and perfume and fragrance of freedom and truth, and the villagers just are like, wow, what is this? I've never seen anything like this before. And they ask, what is this? Where did you get this? And the person that came in says, well, if you follow this path out this way, you'll actually leave the forest and you'll find the open air and the light, unbounded light, and you will get this by doing that. Now, the villagers will say, talk among themselves, and they'll say, oh, wait a minute, you know, we have been taught since time immemorial not to go down that path in that direction, because if we do, we'll be annihilated. We'll be excluded. So it's absolutely taboo. So this person must be trying to trick us and kill us and terrible. But yet, they do have this wonderful presence about them that we want it. We really want it because we're so miserable here in this forest. So we know that there is this, somewhere there is this wonderful something, treasure. We just have to find it. And so they start searching in the forest, and they search here, and they search there, and they search over there, and there, and there, and there, and there, and all these different places. Motivated. They want to get this treasure. They know the treasure, you know, is real. They just don't know where to find it, because they don't believe the one that said, just follow this path, and it'll take you to the treasure. So they search for a lifetime, and many, many searches take place all over. And then they get together after all this effort, and they compare notes, and they say, well, one person says, you know, I searched over in this quadrant, nothing there. Another says, I searched over there, nothing there. Another, over there. And they bring all this together, and they realize that, you know, they've searched almost everywhere in this forest, and they can't find it. They can't find the treasure. So they say, wow, that's terrible. And some say, ah, there never was any treasure. Sour grapes, you know, never was any treasure. Forget it. And others say, no, you know, we're sure that that person that came in, that being that came in, really had found some incredible treasure. So we believe it exists. We just can't find it. Now, there may be someone in the village that says, you know, let's just use some reason on this situation instead of all this emotion and upset, because people are upset. They can't find it. And they say, we've searched everywhere. We can't find it. We're so upset. And then someone says, hey, look, we've searched everywhere in the forest except the one place that this being told us to search by following that path over there. The being said, that's where you'll find it. And we haven't searched there. And the villagers go, whoa, you know, no. That's taboo. Taboo. Can't do it. And then someone says, well, look, it's not anywhere else in the forest. Maybe that taboo is somehow, that is what is tricking us from finding it, the treasure. You know, and the villagers say, well, you know, I don't know, maybe that's possible, maybe not. I don't know, it seems too dangerous, seems too risky. Let's search in other places. And some say, no, we've already done that. It's a waste of time. Let's not waste our time. Okay, we've already been there, done that. So, now, at this point, ask yourself if that being that came into the village has helped anyone there, because they don't have the treasure. They don't have the treasure yet. They can't find it. Has that being that is, let's say, enlightened, a truth teller, someone who has chosen a new idea, who's experiencing unconditional love, no trauma, which is what everybody in the village wants. They see that and say, oh, I want that, no trauma. Wonderful. Has that truth teller, a way shower, have they helped anybody there? That is the question we have to ask ourselves. Now, if you say no to that, okay, no, then isn't it a pitiful thing that the one who has this discovered this great treasure has no way to help anyone else, no way to help them? That's really a pitiful thing, horrible thing. And you would think that the one who the way shower, the truth teller, might be appealing to these people. Say, maybe the truth teller might get sick and depressed and forlorn and hang their head and so tired and say, oh, I'm so upset that you're not finding the treasure that I know is there, and I'm not helping you at all. This is just killing me, just terrible. And then hoping that the villagers will say, oh gosh, isn't that awful? Look, we're really causing a lot of upset to this one here. That would seem to be a logical thing. The complete futility of trying to help anyone here would seem to be devastating. Okay, now let's look at it from another angle. Let's say you say, now wait a minute. The question is, have the people, the villagers in the deep dark forest been helped? And you might say, well, let's look at this through the eyes of reason. What has happened is that the villagers have searched everywhere in the forest for this treasure, except this one place. And they now know it's not anywhere in the where they've searched in the forest. They know that now. You see? So they're in an entirely different place than they used to be. One, they know there is this trauma-free experiencing. And two, they know they really want it. Three, they know where it's not, where it can't be found. So they've already got three legs up on the situation, you see. So from that standpoint, you have to say that the work of the truth teller and the way shower has been extremely helpful to these villagers. Because at the very least, another infusion of this into the village, of this treasure, the fragrance of this treasure, of no trauma, the villagers might say, wow, fantastic, we really, really, really want this now. Gosh, we want it more than ever. And then they'll huddle up and say, okay, now what do we do? And they'll say, well, it makes no sense to search where we've already searched, where we know it's not, can't be found. Doesn't make any sense to do that. So where do we search? And then they'll say, there is this one place we haven't searched in. So probably what we need to do is we need to look at this one place we haven't searched in yet. That's the fourth leg of the situation, right? And the fifth leg of the situation is they search there and they find it. So by coming into this world and showing the non-traumatic experience. At the very least, you get three legs up. Everyone gets three legs up just like that. And it's quite possible, by repeated beings coming into this world, you get the five legs of it, the whole thing. The full Monty, you get it all. Because eventually people will say, hey, we need to search in this one place we haven't searched yet. So it is not a wasted thing to come into this world and showcase the non-traumatic state, even though nobody in this world will look in the right place and they won't, and nobody will find it. It's not a waste of time at all. It gives them three legs up. Saves them incredible time. Because they search in all the wrong places, looking for love in all the wrong places. And yet now they know it's not there. It's not there. You can't find it there. They've eliminated all this stuff. And through a process of elimination, they now will turn towards where it can be found. So because we've been under the spell of this of a belief system for so long, the process of elimination is just about the only way we can really deal with the situation. Really, from a pragmatic standpoint, there does need to be a process of elimination, saying not here, not here, neti, 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 not this, not this, not this. It's very tough for us because, well, ultimately we have to say not this belief system and not any belief system, really. Okay. Ultimately, we have to say that, and we're not ready to say that. When we haven't searched in the right direction, we're not ready to say that. So we have to cling to our belief system, and we use it by saying, not here, not here, not here, not here. We don't really want to find yet where it is, but we can find where it isn't. Okay? And that's how this world, those who are in the thraldom of a belief system, that's how they have to function. Not here, not here, not here. The important thing is that your search is very vigorous. Okay, and I can speak from my own experience. I'd had very intense, vigorous search. Not here, not here, not here. And I can tell you all these different places I've searched. It's not there. It's not there. Not only that, I've done a collaborative effort in reading books and other people's searches and finding out where they search and saying that's not there either. So you can find out all these different places where it cannot be found. You really can do it. But it has to be intense and vigorous because there seems to be a lot of places to search in. And you know, do a very vigorous search and say, okay, this can't be found here or there or there or there or there. And a wise person will take other people's searches into account. Collaborative. Really, the spiritual path on this planet should be collaborative. Doesn't have to be personal interaction, but collaborative can mean videos, books, talks, all sorts of various things. People sharing their wisdom, you know, like where, you know, they've done this and this and this and it hasn't worked. And you can just see those who are saying, well, we think this might work. We believe this will work. And you can see it hasn't worked for them. So you get that. It's collaborative here. You know, don't think you have to do it all yourself. You can, like I said, I've said in other videos, like my dad was a great traveler and went to all the lands of the earth, you know, to the ends of the earth, really, all over. And he came back at the end of that long, lifelong exploration of the planet and told me, he said, couldn't find it. It's not there. You'll never find it. You'll never find it out there. You will not. And I took that to heart and said, I don't need to do any traveling, you know, because I know he was a great traveler and gave an honest report and saved me all that time. Saved me all that time, you see? So those who do make great efforts to find it, they come back and they say, I didn't find it. Trust them. Trust what they tell you. They didn't, because I didn't. They didn't find it. You can tell. You can tell. They're honest. Hey, I didn't find it. You know they didn't find it. Well, say, where did you go? What did you do? Listen to them. So you can look at history. You can look at all the effort searches, you know, and you can just say, wow, you know, they're not finding it. Rarely is it ever found. What's the problem? And then you start thinking, well, I'm not going to waste my time searching where everyone else, you know, couldn't find it. So that's a fool's errand. Let's not do that. Don't just think, well, they're just too stupid, they couldn't find it. No, they're searching in the wrong place. You know, these people, you know, don't disparage the past, really. That's very important. Don't think the people in the past were stupid. They weren't. Just because they couldn't find it. They weren't stupid. They were just looking in the wrong place. That's not stupid. That's being enthralled by a belief system, which we all are, and still enthralled by it. You know, the idea of somehow the people in the past, our ancestors, were really kind of country bumpkins and we're so much wiser and smarter and more sophisticated now, and we can't really trust anything that they went through, is nonsense. They're super smart. I can tell you my ancestors, the ones that I met, were super smart. And they couldn't find it. They didn't find it. And everyone I've met in my life has been super smart, and none of them found it. And I can just tell from other people in society, they also are super smart, and their ancestors were super smart, and they couldn't find it. So it's all about looking in the right place. So learn the lessons of history. It's super important to learn the lessons of history and save yourself time so you don't repeat them. Okay. And there's a lot of, you know, you have to be very careful about that, about thinking that somehow you're in a different state of mind than those in the past. It's not true. It's all the same. It's all the same. Now, people who use drugs, the problem is they think they're in a different state of mind than their ancestors or their parents, their grandparents, their great-grandparents, et cetera, et cetera. They look at the generations before and say, ah, those people had no idea what I'm experiencing. They can't relate to what I'm seeing at all. They don't know anything about how my state of mind. Well, your state of mind is being produced by drugs, you see. The generational gap was produced by drugs. The 60s started the generation gap. It was called the generation gap, which was the worst ever. You know, it's a natural thing for, you know, in this world to have some, but we had a severe generational gap starting in the 60s with the drug culture. Because we realized that our parents, our grandparents, our ancestors couldn't relate to what we were experiencing at all, okay? Our generation, because our generation was on drugs, and previous generations did not use drugs, by and large. It was very rare. And so we assumed that our ancestors were stupid because we were having a completely different experience. They couldn't relate to it. We said, oh, they must be stupid. They can't relate to me. No, they can't relate to the drug trip that we were on, you know. Generation, speaking generationally. They couldn't relate to that. That didn't make them stupid. Not at all. In fact, they were probably smarter than we were because they realized that that wasn't the way to go. That, too, is a waste of time. Somehow they had an intuitive understanding that was a waste of time, and they were absolutely right. I know my parents and grandparents and great-grandparents in that generation in general rejected drug use entirely. They said, no, that's not the way to go. Absolutely is not. They were 100% right. See, so they weren't stupid. So it's very important to not try to get in a state of mind, artificial state of mind, and play those mind games and stuff. And that breeds a superiority complex, generational superiority complex, where you reject the older people and their wisdom, because their wisdom is one of the most helpful things for you possible, because they'll tell you what they've done, amassed a lifetime of searching. They'll say, I didn't find it, and don't you waste your time doing what I did. That is really, you know, the old people, they want to pass on, they want to help the younger generations. When they get older, that is what they want to do. And the one thing they want to do is say to the younger generations, don't waste your time the way I wasted my time. Don't waste your time. Believe me. Listen to me. I wasted my time. I searched in all the wrong places. I didn't find what I was looking for. Don't you make the same mistake. But this planet, there's been an effort to short-circuit this wisdom here. Through drugs, through all sorts of pop stuff that seemed to create a great divide between the generations, where there doesn't seem to be the relating between the generations is not good, and the youth tends to just, you know, now just reject anything the older people say. Ah, what do they know? They didn't have computers, they didn't have all these smartphones, they didn't have all these designer drugs, they didn't have, you know, all the sophistication that we have. What do they know about anything? Well, all of those older people have spent a lifetime searching and not finding, so they certainly know all about not finding, and so they can tell you that. It's crazy. I mean, like the 60s generation, the generation gap, the drug generation, all that, they've been telling the younger generations, hey, don't look there, you know, you won't find it there. That's a complete waste of time, and they're not listening, wasting their time again. It's amazing how people are, the youth are wasting their time severely. I'm amazed that people who work on like ranches, farms, that were at survival mode, really out in the boondocks, they listen to their parents, they listen to our generation, because it's survival. And the older people pass on and say, hey, here's how you do stuff really efficiently and smoothly and stay out of trouble. Here's how you do it. And they listen, they pick it up, because if they do it, you know, in a bad way, it could mean their survival. So they pay great attention, and it's passed down. So what works and what doesn't work? You know, on a grander scale in this world, where do you find this great treasure, and where do you not find it? That is all important, all important. So I searched among my elders, looking for, you know, who found it. Or who didn't find it, and who did find it, and you know, those who didn't find it, where did they search, and those who did find it, where do they search, and try to, you know, save time. Saving time is what it's all about on the spiritual path. Because if you don't do that, you'll go too slow, and you'll lose your motivation. You have to save time. And one of the very best ways, again, is to listen to those who haven't found it, and warn you, don't waste your time this way, and also listen to those who have found it and say that this is where it's at. But the thing is we will listen to those who haven't found it more, because again, we are enthralled with this belief system, thinking that we have to operate within this belief system, within that context, which is again not here, not here, not here, not here, because we don't realize that you can't find it within the belief system at all. You have to exchange belief systems. In other words, you have to exchange ideas, really. It's a better way of putting it, exchange ideas. And you have to, and only in going in that direction are you going to finally find that treasure that you know is there. So it's right when you're in the youth of your life. Don't say, Look at it like you're in the youth of your life, or the middle age of your life, or whatever you are. You're in an opportunity simply to look in the right place. That's all. And if you're young, you say, wow, I've got this great opportunity to look in the right place now. I've got all these older people, all this vast wealth of information that will clue me in, you know, where to look and where not to look. And so I have a great opportunity. You know, that's the way to use your youth. Don't use your youth in trying to set up some weird culture that is like totally different than the previous culture, so that you can feel that somehow you're separate from the previous cultures and you're special, somehow special, because those other, you know, the past cannot relate to me at all, because I'm the future, I'm different, I'm better. That's a waste of time. Very foolish to do that. Just look at the others who have done that and realize that that didn't work either. Look at the 60s generations. We did that. It didn't work. Didn't work. Still looking all the wrong places. We just thought it was really cool places to look in. Okay? And so generational reports are super and super important. It's one of the greatest heirlooms there is. It probably is the greatest heirloom in this world, is the passing down, the making of generational reports that inform you, look, this doesn't work. You know, even looking in these really cool places doesn't work. Looking in sophisticated places doesn't work. Looking in high-tech places doesn't work. We know that too. We know all these things already. So we're narrowing it down, you know. And we're getting to the point now where we say, hey, we need to just simply choose a new idea. You know, that's the remedy. That's how I've been able to narrow it down. Now I just see very clearly that's the answer. There isn't any other answer. You're looking anywhere else, you're not going to find the answer. And so it is possible to narrow it down by saving yourself time, by picking up those heirlooms of the past, you know, saying, hey, we did this, it didn't work, we did this, it didn't work. And then eventually you say, wow, nothing has worked. Yeah, I start thinking about that. Although you have some who come into the world, like Ramana Maharshi or Nanda Magma, those types, who they do have this great treasure, no trauma. No matter what happens, they don't experience any trauma. No matter what happens, the whole universe could go into complete, intense trauma. They wouldn't experience that at all. So they have this treasure, and you see, well, it is possible, even be in this world and have this treasure. So we know it's real, we know it's there. So that's very important, and yet now we know we're thinking, okay, it's not here, not here, not here, not here, trying to find it, align ourselves, and at some point we say, hey, maybe it's not in the effects of existence at all, maybe it's not in this belief system at all, maybe we need to choose a new idea. Okay, instead of trying to change the effects of an idea, choose a new idea. Maybe that's the answer. If we eliminate all the rest of this stuff, then we can approach where it really can be found, we can approach it with a lot more confidence and a lot more motivation and say, wait a minute, I don't want to go look anywhere else because I know it's not there, so let me stick with this, you see. That is how it works. That's how I work. I say, everything tries to keep pulling me back. No. You know, I've done that, been there, done that, doesn't work. Been there, doesn't work. Forget it. And it's that way. It's not like I'm using any mental powers or tricks or anything. No, not like that. I just say, hey, you know, forget it. I've done, been there, done that. Didn't work. And, you know, get right back to choose a new idea. I can do that. And ultimately, that's what works. Because again, we are terrified of leaving this belief system, letting go of this belief system. Because belief believes in itself. I talked about in the video, dweller, getting past the dweller on the threshold. There is this dweller on the threshold, which belief is 100% believing in belief. And it unnerves. And that is there. And we have to get past that point, and it's very difficult. And you will tend to be very vulnerable to going searching somewhere else instead of facing up to that dweller on the threshold. But if you've already searched everywhere else, you know, or you've taken other collaborative, you know, advice where others have searched in all these different places and you realize it's not there, then you can say, no, wait a minute. No, I'm not going to go off on a tangent. I'm going to stay right here and look at this dweller on the threshold and figure out how I can get past this. How can I get past this? I say, I know I got to get past it. I know the answer's right there. I have to choose a new idea, but I have to get face up to this dweller on the threshold, this belief system that believes in itself totally. Belief believes in belief. And I have to say, I don't believe in belief. Or not that. You say, I choose not to have a belief system anymore. Okay, I choose to exchange belief systems if you want to. That's a gentler, sort of softening the blow way of looking at it. A Course in Miracles says that exchange belief systems. What you're really doing is you're exchanging ideas, causal agents. You have to get to that point and say, no, I have the authority and the right to choose a new idea. And belief systems will never give me what I really want. Never. Because belief only believes in belief, and there's no belief in reality whatsoever. So belief denies reality. It shuts it out. There is no realization of reality within a belief system. Belief believes in belief, the power of belief, and there is no power in belief, none. And you don't really want to continue on with what has no power, no meaning, just aimless, meaningless, powerless nothingness. Why continue on with that? You don't really want that. But you have to get past that 100% belief of belief in belief. How do you do that? You see, that is the tough, that's what keeps you going on tangents. And you say, well, let me go back to my music. Let me compose some more songs, you know, because that was really great. It kind of soothed me. That happens all the time. Like, I'll start a little tune or something. Before you know it, builds and builds and builds. And then there's this song just going through the head constantly. And it's like calling you back, like, oh, you should just go back to music, you know. Why don't you compose some more music? You're so good at it. I can compose songs in my head easily. Really, really fabulous songs, you know. But I say, well, wait a minute. I've been there and I've done that. I've already been there and done that, you know. And it didn't work. Music doesn't work. I can tell sure music doesn't work. That's something I can pass on as an heirloom, because I've been there and done that to the nth degree, really. And I could compose endless beautiful music, endless. But I know that will not suffice for what we really want at all. That is, again, simply seeking for the great treasure within belief. So I just say, no. Stop that song. I used to write him down, you know, and say, baby, I can make that into a great song. Well, of course, yeah, it's possible, but it's a waste of time. So I can pass that on, you know. I can pass a lot of various things on that don't work, that for sure don't work, and that can save, you know, enormous time. You might save a lifetime saying, hey, I'm not going to try and do, you know, spend my life doing this. It doesn't work. And say, I trust what, you know, the advice I've been given. Only by getting past that dweller on the threshold will you get free. That is what is standing in all of our ways, actually. What is that? The belief in belief. Belief believing in belief. It's self-referential. It sees itself, belief, as the self. There is no other reference. It thinks belief is identity. Belief believes that belief is identity, that it is reality. Or it will become reality. Which, to belief, is the same thing. Right? If it's a fait accompli, there's no meaningful difference between something that has not yet become and but yet something that is certain to become. There's no meaningful distinction there. If something's certain to happen, then it essentially has already happened, really. There's no real meaningful difference. It's only a time thing, right? So belief thinks it's only a time thing. Any objections to belief, belief takes as just a time objection over time. How, when's it going to happen? How long? So it dismisses. It says, you know, it seems to be very compassionate. Belief seems to be very compassionate, very spiritual, actually. And you complain to it, belief says it will give you all this spiritual pablum, you know, because it thinks, well, you just don't understand yet. That is only a problem with time, and there, you know, you belief will succeed in its agenda. It's just you need to be more patient with it, you know, that kind of thing, and spins out endless spiritual teachings. The belief system does. None of it is valid. It's completely invalid. Because it's not a time thing. It is not a fait accompli. The agenda of the belief system will never be reached. And it was futile from the very beginning, remains futile, it was impossible from the very beginning, remains impossible. That is the truth. It's 100% meaningless. Has zero meaning. None. Okay. That is the truth. And you have to have that clarity to face up to that dweller on the threshold and say, you're not going to tell me what I can choose. I'm the one who does the choosing, not you. I can choose a new idea. Whereas belief, all belief can do is keep living in belief. That's all that it can do. And it thinks that that's some kind of power. It's not any power. It's delusion. It's fear. It's insanity. There's no power in insanity. It's just wasting time. I guess you might say it has some kind of delaying capability. But again, since inevitably we will choose a new idea, there's no real difference, meaningful difference at all between us not yet doing it and when we will do it. That is only a matter of time. See, that is the truth, and it's therefore meaningless. So that's the right way to turn it around on the belief system. It is a matter of time before we discard the belief system. That is true, and realize it's futile. That is only a matter of time, right? So you see, you have to stand up to this dweller on the threshold through clarity. That's the only way. You don't stand up to it by mainlining espresso, you know, which a lot of people try by chugging energy drinks, because you feel like this dweller on the threshold saps you of energy. It intimidates you. It drains you of your resolve. It really does. It really does. Some of you have said how tired you feel, etc., because you are trying to get past the dweller threshold. You're trying, and it makes you very tired. And the problem is you feel this tiredness, and you say, "My gosh, if I only had a little more energy, I could do it." And so, the temptation is to mainline energy drinks. You know, I went through a period of drinking French coffee, which is very, very strong. I mean, it's direct immersion. You grind up the coffee, and it's being directly steeped in the water, and just, you know, just drinking. I was trying to get enough energy to get past that dweller on the threshold, you know, and it almost killed me, really. It almost killed me. It's very bad. And then I went, you know, I tried again and again, tried to get some energy, and each time it almost killed me. It's very dangerous to do it that way. Because again, you think if you just have that vitality, you know, you can get past it. As if it was some kind of physical, you know, like a battle of nerves. Well, it is kind of a battle of nerves, but you can't do it artificially. Because what'll happen is if you try to do it that way with artificial energy and nerve, you won't make it, and you'll go into paranoia, and you'll go into side trips. And since you'll be mainlining espresso or whatever, you'll have all this energy to pursue these side trips, and then you'll go way, way off on these side trips. That happened to me, okay? That happened to me. I got sidetracked. I went on a side trip. It's a couple of very, very severe side trips. Because using that energy, that artificial energy, you're able to pursue these side trips, and you don't even know what you're doing. You're thinking, wow, I'm getting there. I'm really getting there. It's just a side trip. So it's very important to not use artificial energy when you're on the spiritual path, because you inevitably will get pushed into side trips. And if you're actually tired, you won't pursue them. You'll say, wow, I'm really tired. I don't have the energy to pursue that. But I do have the energy to focus on choosing a new idea. I can sit here and do that, but I don't have the energy to, you know, be a world beater in some way. And then you'll get right back to focus again on getting past the dweller threshold, and you won't be on a side trip. See? That's why I said it's super important right now. If you're trying to get past the dweller on the threshold, and you're feeling the fatigue, you're feeling mean, don't amp it up. Don't amp it up in an artificial way. But what people do is they use sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Okay, that's what our generation did. It's continued on and on because we're trying to get past that obstacle, the dweller on the threshold. And we can't do it. We haven't been able to do it. And we keep trying to build our courage up. You know, we call it Dutch courage. That's how my grandparents and parents and grandparents call it Dutch courage. Meaning at that time it was, you know, hitting the bottle. You know, using drugs, hitting the bottle, whatever. It was a colloquialism at the time. It's not really used much anymore because we're so, you know, politically correct at this time. But the idea is that you're trying to get up the courage to do something artificially, okay? And so the planet is really doing that now. They're really trying hard, but unfortunately it doesn't work. In fact, it makes things worse. Makes things worse, go on side trips. And, you know, you got, instead of walking on a side trip, you're taking a jet plane on a side trip, you know. You're going way far astray. Whereas if you were just walking, you might go a little bit astray, and then you say, ah, I'm so tired, I can't walk anymore. And then you say, I better go back to my home, and you don't go that far away. But if you get on a jet, and you jet to some other place, some other country, and you go there, and you get into that, and before you know it, you've completely lost track of what the heck you were trying to do in the first place. Very dangerous situation. And it can be really traumatic, very traumatic. You have to look out. So when you're experiencing the fatigue of trying to get past the dweller, which it causes, because it saps your nerves, you feel scared. You know, you feel intimidated. It's a weird thing. You don't know where it's coming from either. You don't understand it. You know, we don't, reality, there's no belief in reality. So we have nothing to go on with this belief. It's just weird. We don't know how to deal with it. We really don't. And it enervates us. It enervates us. It's a strain. What you have to do is you have to just accept that it's the price you're paying. And when you're tired, you take a rest. I'm tired all the time. I just took a rest before this taping. You know, I was so tired. Tired right now. I'm always tired. Because it's a strain. Because you're trying, you know, I'm trying to stand up to this dweller on the threshold and say, I'm the one who's in charge here. I'm making the choice. And you, belief system, you're incapable of making the right choice. You can't make any choice. You're just self-referential, just idolizing yourself, you know. That's all you're doing. And that's, it is, you know, it wears you out. So instead of, don't be harsh on yourself. If you're fatigued, if you're strained, you know, it's probably because you are really getting the job done. But then again, don't try to be the superstar and say, you know, hey, if I take mainline energy drinks, I'll get it done faster and I'll be able to help save the world. That's what happened to me, you know. It's like I got this whole thing, you know, run on me about, you know, hey, if you just do it faster, you'll be able to really, really, really help the world greatly. And so then I got into artificial energy, and then that took me on severe side trips and ended up delaying the whole thing. You know, it was very cleverly done, very deceitful and tricky. Is if you want to get on a side trip, believe me, the universe will help you do that. Absolutely will help you, give you everything you need to get on a side trip. That's what I found. Everything I needed showed up, which is why I thought it was legitimate. You know, you're told on the spiritual path, everything you need shows up. But what I found when I was on a side trip, everything I needed showed up. It was incredible. I literally was aware of everything I needed. I was aware I could find it amazingly. I could find anything. Someone could ask me to find the most obscure thing in the world, and I could find it in a day. It's incredible. And I wasn't using the internet. I was able to just somehow tap into some kind of universal knowledge and awareness, and I knew where everything was, and I could find it. But and so miracles, constantly miraculous things where I'd meet people who would help me along the way, and yet it was all a side trip. It was all designed to mislead and deceive and waste time. But I thought it was a spiritual trip. You know, this is what's supposed to happen when you're on the path. Everything works out for you. It's a side trip. Because the universe is a belief system, and this belief system will certainly help you believe in the belief system. Absolutely it will. It will clear the path for you. But that's a false path. Whereas if you turn back to the real path, to choosing a new idea, I haven't experienced any of that so-called miraculous spiritual stuff. At all. No. It's like the universe suddenly dropped me as a client, you know, not helping anymore. But that hasn't stopped me at all from making fantastic progress and clarification. That hasn't stopped at all. That's gotten better, way better, compared to being on the side trip. It's weird. On the side trip, I had just seemed to have unbelievably miraculous, great, good fortune in that everything showed up, and I just thought, wow, you know, this is it. It ended up to be a complete dead end. Nothing but a waste of time, a side trip. A super scam. The universe scams everyone. It's a total scam in itself. The universe is nothing but a scam. This belief system we call the universe will continually mislead us and scam us. It's a genius at doing that and can produce what seem to be, you know, miracles, constant stream of miracles to help us do that. To help maintain our belief in belief and keep us from looking at what really works. And so the only miracle I have had since getting off those side trips is the miracle of being able to focus on what really works in a completely simple, basic way, which is what really works. There hasn't been any, you know, cool stuff. There hasn't been any, glamorous stuff or stuff you'd think, wow, that's really spiritual. It hasn't been anything like that. Let me turn this on. I'll turn this other one on too. Now let me cut down the brightness of it. Sun is setting. All right, that's a little better. It's very unglamorous when you're on the real path. It's very unglamorous, and it seems like you don't have the kind of miracles you had before at all. That's very, very true. I had thousands and thousands of miracles. It's unbelievable. I could know exactly what the weather was going to be, 6 hours from now in some place 100 miles from here. And I'd go there, and the weather would be exactly as I saw it would be. And just amazing stuff nonstop. And I thought, for sure, I must be going down the road towards great destiny. And supposedly, I was told, helping the world out immeasurably. But the fact was, that was not true at all. It was a complete lie. I was going down the road of distraction and side trips and delaying and wasting time towards helping the world. And yet it was all done, with spiritual teachers and inner guidance, and everything seemed to be perfectly okay, And yet there's something within me said, there's something that doesn't quite add up here, but I said, well, is everything still happening? I'm getting all this guidance. It must be there. Now, it ended up being a complete dead end. Disastrous type of thing. And that's what happens to us. That is why we don't, that's what happens. If you really want to get past the dweller on the threshold, you're going to experience this terrible strain, and you become vulnerable to these side trips. And these side trips, I'll tell you, they've got a very glossy brochure to give you. Very glossy. And it's likely going to, everybody will fall for it at some point. Trying to get just the right thing here, but most people will fall for it. It's almost inevitable. At some point, you fall for it. And so you have to get out of it somehow. And I found it's very tough, but it's doable. It's very tough. Don't seek for the glamorous type of miracles and things like you think your whole life is all being guided. Everything is working out perfectly for you, because the universe will do that for you. But it's not legitimate. The one thing that it won't do is won't guide you to simply sit quietly and use inquiry, satsang, and contemplation towards choosing a new idea and getting past the dweller on the threshold. It'll ignore that. It'll say, no. Jesus is returning. Ananda Mayama is returning. No, all these spiritual gurus are returning. You need to get ready for their return. You need to do all this stuff for them. That's what they'll say. They'll say something great is going to happen, whatever it is. Belief will just make it up. And then you get all these archetypes that seem to be helping you, and everything is just belief system, is very inventive, very inventive. And you will be misled. Waste of time. Forget about the teacher coming back, that teacher coming back. This is going to happen, that's going to happen. Forget about all that. Instead, spend your time saying, okay, how can I get past that dweller on the threshold? That 100% belief. How can I get clear enough? Spend your time doing that. And you will, when someone comes up to you and says, hey, you're a great musician. There's going to be a great spiritual revival, and we need you to compose the music for it, And you say, oh, wow. In the past, you'd say, oh, my gosh, this is what I've been waiting for my whole life. Now you'll just say, go to hell, stop wasting my time. No one who has chosen a new idea and is in unconditional love needs any soundtrack to be here, okay? They don't need it. If they want it, they can produce it themselves like that. Like I said, if I get into the frame of mind, I can write 30 songs in a day if I wanted to. And I can, in one day, I can produce a soundtrack if needed. you know, probably not even needed at all. Probably not even needed at all. There's the idea that there's some, you know, some teachers, in the great teachers in the world, that need you to do all the stuff for them is completely bogus. Completely bogus. That's only a belief system defending itself in a very clever way. And yet we get pulled into it because if we have some ability, we want it to use it to help people, right? So if you're like a musician, an artist, a business person, you name it, you want to be able to use that to help people. And so the universe will say, hey, you know, there's this great opportunity if you just, you know, use your talents and work on it, you know, feverishly all the time, then you'll be super helpful. And you may say, well, I'm so tired. And they say, well, you know, you just need to get more, have more energy. And you need to do a better job, and you think, and you're thinking, and you get kind of guided, and you look, and you see, oh, an energy drink. Wow, I wonder if I tried that, maybe I could, you know, produce more music or do whatever. And so then you drink the energy drink, and wow, you're all wired, and you're able to like work around the clock, you know, and you get more tired, and you drink more, and before you know it, you're all strung out in some way, and feeling kind of guilty because you're too tired, and before you know it, your health collapses, all this stuff, terrible. And of course, you feel so guilty, you say, I can't stop because I'm doing this to help the world. Nonsense. All that is a total lie. The world doesn't need any creative endeavor whatsoever to help it towards truth. It does not need any of that. And what the world needs is for people to simply sit quietly and silently and be the observer and be very observant and very quiet. That is all. Because the truth is within and is revealed through this quiet sitting where you don't feel you need to do anything. There is no teacher of truth that is asking you to forego this quiet contemplation to somehow pump up their presence here, you know. It's not true. Whatever little needs to be done will be done. But they are telling you what you need to do is sit in quiet contemplation. You don't need to be composing music. You don't need to be assembling wardrobes. You don't need to be making tons of money. You don't need to be part of a makeup department. You don't need to be making videos and for them, or you know, all this whatever stuff, recordings, help them publish books, all this kind of stuff. You don't need to be doing that. That's not the purpose of them being here. The purpose of them being here is to inspire you to quiet contemplation. To sit quietly and simply focus that time on truth 100%, not on doing anything else, not even in writing. Maybe you could write the greatest symphony that there ever was. Maybe you could write 100 of them. It's infinitely better for you to sit there and not do that, and instead focus 100% on truth. That is an absolute fact. And I can tell you from experience, I could write any type of music and make it better and better and better and better and better. But it's way infinitely better to not do that. And it's to sit here quietly, you know, doing satsang, doing inquiry, sharing it. You know, sharing it is easy. I've found an easy way to do it. It's not absorbing all my time, which is a bad thing. I could also make very good movies and videos, actually, if I used to. Had all the programs, After Effects and a Premiere, and Photoshop and other specialty programs with all these effects and abilities, and I could do meticulous stuff. You know, I could just like for like a 30 seconds, I could spend, you know, a week devising this incredible stuff. Waste of time, you know. But I was thinking, you know, it'd be really great to have a super great intro, you know, for a video for some great teacher that's going to show up here, and everybody will see that and say, oh, that's totally cool. I want to see what's going on. Wasted my time. Unbelievable stuff. If any teacher ever tells you that they're going to show up or something, say, well, fine, when we show up, you show up. Meanwhile, I'm going to stay with my contemplation. Because any true guru would say that's exactly what you need to do. Stay with your contemplation. Don't prepare for me to show up. In fact, staying with your contemplation is the only way to prepare for it. It's the only way. And if some sort of thing needs to be done to help move their situation along, you can do it like that. It'll be done. Not waste your time at all. So there are infinite ways to waste your time in this universe. Infinite ways. Some of them are very clever and very tricky and very glamorous. And you know, you might have Jesus appear to you and tell you all this stuff and how he's coming back, and you have to do this, you know, and you think, oh my gosh, how can I say no? You know, that can happen. Some great guru, some avatar, whatever, can appear to you and say, he wants you to build this temple. You know, that's another great one. Oh my gosh, this happened throughout history so many times, that some great avatar, guru, manifestation of God will appear to somebody and they'll say, you know, what I want you to do is I want you to build this great temple. And so what do? They enlist this huge movement. You get thousands of people in this movement, donations, and they spend like a lifetime building some huge temple, you know. And gosh, and so many other people participate in that, and they don't spend their time contemplating, truly contemplating. What contemplating means, not doing anything other than that, having no other goal but truth. It means not having a goal of building some big temple or some religious building, not having a goal of building some hospital or charitable thing, not having a goal of producing the best music the world's ever heard, the best art, the best culture, the best book, the best anything. That means only saying, I'm going to do the best contemplation that I can possibly do. That's it. No other goal. Only that is true meditation. Only that is true contemplation. There can't be any other goal involved. That you are going to find the way to get past that dweller on the threshold. I may have to take a break here. Okay. That's it. That is it. Only that is it. So I'm telling you from my own experience, having gone through all of this stuff, that this is true. And you think that you're insulting these gurus and sages and saints and saviors and avatars and all this stuff that can appear to you. How dare you turn them down? Hold on. So you think that you're insulting him. You think, how dare I, this little peon, you know, insult the king of the universe, you know. But remember, the king of the universe is only a belief. It's part of the belief system. It's just a belief. And you are the child of reality. You're not the child of belief. You are greater than any belief system. In fact, you're infinitely greater than any belief system, because all belief systems are nothing. They're simply hypothetical, which is nothing, will never become actual. So you absolutely have the right to turn down anything that appears to you that tells you, you know, you need to go on the side trip. You need to do anything other than contemplation. That's a side trip. You can turn them down. Turn them down. There's a saying, if you see the Buddha on the road, kill the Buddha. Okay? We had that in the 60s. That was a very popular saying, which means exactly that. If the Buddha appears to you on the path and says, you are such a great, you know, aspirant, a sannyasi, or whatever the term is, And I've singled you out to help me out, you know, spread the Dharma all over the world. And I need for you to go and establish all these different temples and, you know, whatever, places of worship. And I need you to do this and this and this. And you say, oh my gosh, the Buddha has realized my great devotion and wants me to do this. How can I say no? No. You say no. Forget it. Get out of here. You're just a figment of belief, figment of my imagination. I'm going to stick with contemplation. That's what you have to do. And unfortunately, you know, even though I heard it, it didn't sink in enough. And which is why it bears repeating. No matter what appears to you subtly or in any way, if it is any way moving you away from your contemplation, drop it. Drop it. Comes from belief. See, you think you're a child of belief. And so it's very difficult. And within that belief system, belief can believe in anything. Belief can send an imaginary Anandamayama to you, for instance, and say that, you know, you need to help. Imaginary Jesus, imaginary Buddha, imaginary anything, imaginary God. And say, tap you on the shoulder and say, I need your help. You know, you're the one who's going to help me out, because I see how devoted you are. No, what it is that the belief system sees how devoted you are to getting past the belief system and dropping it. And it's threatened by that, very threatened. And flatters you plays upon your vanity and flatters you, saying, "Hey, you know, you're really devoted. That's great," and you know, and here's God, and God wants your help. And you say, "Wow, how can I turn it down? Turn it down. Absolutely, turn it down. Forget it. It's a fool's errand." You end up in a dead end, a terrible dead end. Especially if you keep, you know, consuming artificial energy to keep on working on it. You'll spend a lifetime, and you'll waste your lifetime that way. Turn it all down. Turn all that stuff down and say, "No, I'm just going to stick with contemplation because that's what works." You can get to the point where you can get past the dweller on the threshold. You absolutely can. You can lower your anxiety and stress levels from 99% to 1%, and maybe even lower than that, through contemplation. That's how it's done. You have to put up with the fatigue, and you have to get your rest, put up with the strain. You know, it's unpleasant because you're worried, you're frightened, you're not sure, you're intimidated, all that stuff. But you just stick with it, stick with it, stick with it, stick with it. And again, at the start of the video, I showed how anybody who gets past the dweller on the threshold and chooses a new idea has the presence of unconditional love, trauma-free experiencing here in this world. And everyone in the world will say, "That's what I really want," you know, because we have the truth within us. And everybody will say, "Whoa, that's what I really want. All this other stuff I just think that I want, that's what I really want." You know, they can't help themselves, because it is what they really want. And then, of course, they'll go searching in all the wrong places. But at least they will know that it can't be found in any of these places. And then they will focus on, say, "Well, we have to search where in this one place we haven't looked at." So you will help the world greatly that way. You won't be wasting your time at all. It's a great, 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 great help to the world for anybody to choose a new idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator. Super helpful. And yet the belief tells us, no, it's a waste of time. What you really need to do is to help out this so-called God of the universe, strengthen belief in that, you know, and do all this stuff, other stuff. Just stay away from this contemplation that, you know, it's dangerous, very dangerous. That's the taboo. The villagers in the deep forest, there's this taboo, and his contemplation is that taboo. That's the path that is taboo. And everybody, you know, is told, "Oh, don't go down that path, you know, oh, that's dangerous, dangerous stuff down there." We say, "Oh, really? Why? Oh, you know, it just don't even ask, you know, don't even ask. It's too dangerous to even ask. Just forget about it." Go help out the God of the universe. The God of the universe needs a lot of help, right? A lot of help. Endless help. And ultimately, completely futile, complete waste of time. God of a belief system is imaginary. It's just a figment of imagination, a figment of belief. It's just belief believing in belief. That's the God of belief, is belief believing in belief. That's all that it is. And insisting that there is nothing else other than this belief believing in belief. And telling us that is our God. It is not our God. It's nothing. It's absolutely nothing. Our God is the God, prime creator of creation, the rules, the laws of creation, that is absolutely fantastic, wonderful, beyond anything we can even imagine. No vulnerability, no threat, no trauma. Everything that is eternal, endless. All right? Doesn't suffer any change or impermanence whatsoever. We have no threat there. There is no threat, no such thing as threat, no such thing as trauma. Endless delight, endless rich tapestry of experiencing. That is reality. We're a child of reality. We're not a child of belief. And the belief plays us all for fools, okay? And if you can benefit from the experience of those who have, you know, been played for fools, you're way ahead of the game. Way ahead of the game, you know. Those who realize that if you see the Buddha on the road, kill the Buddha. The subtle Buddha, in other words. If you understand that meaning, say, no. Forget it. Forget it. I'm sticking with contemplation. I'm not going to be part of your entourage. Let me just be very quiet, very humble. Stick with contemplation. That is the way to do it. And, you know, so anyone who gets that, whoa, they're way ahead of the game. Way ahead of the game. Those are the ones who are going to finish soon. Okay, And the ones that get sidetracked, of course, they don't finish as soon as they could have if they didn't get sidetracked. But again, getting sidetracked is really what happens here. You know, almost everybody's gotten sidetracked. Almost everyone. Very, very few have actually chosen a new idea. Very few. So almost everybody has gotten sidetracked. Not only sidetracked, but severely sidetracked. So if you are able to focus on contemplation, you are way ahead of the game. Way, way, way ahead of the game. Because very few are doing that. Very few. Because they're out trying to save the world. Trying to, you know, help some imaginary God of the universe, some imaginary Buddha, some imaginary Jesus, some imaginary, you know, Ramana or Nandamayama or anything like that. And that's not to say that these great beings, these finishers, those who are abiding in unconditional love, that's not to say that they don't help us or don't contact us at all. Sometimes they do. But there's a great difference. There's a great difference because when they do, what they impart to us is to stay with the contemplation. That's why I told you the time when I was focused on A Course in Miracles, you know, to an extreme extent. I had many, many subtle encounters with Jesus during the dream sleep state. And all those encounters was saying, faster, faster, more, 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 come on. More contemplation, more contemplation. Forget about the words, contemplate, boil it down, you know, come on. Finish, finish, finish. That's all it was. It wasn't anything glamorous. Same with Anandamayama. The legitimate experiences were, you know, focus, you know, that you need to really, really focus, 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 concentrate, concentrate, contemplate, contemplate, more, 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 more. Troubles are coming, you have to really apply yourself, you know, don't take it easy. That was, I think, the main thing, said, don't take it easy, don't take it easy. Work at it hard, work at it hard. Don't just kind of drift and say, hey, everything's fine. It's not, existence is traumatic. Get after it. And Ramana, the same thing. The one instance that Ramana was, he said, hey, don't quit what you're doing. Keep at it, keep at it, keep at it. If you're doing really good, keep at it. Just stay right on track. That's what the teachers will tell you. That's what the legitimate encounters will tell you. Get after it. The contemplation, not the building of temples. All right? Anandamayama always says the world has more than enough temples and religious buildings and spiritual buildings, more than enough, she says. Don't need to build anymore. You know, everybody wanted to build temples. They go to her and say, I'm so inspired, Ma. I feel like going out building a temple for you, an ashram, whatever. She goes, no. I don't need any ashrams. I don't need any temples. I don't need any building. The world has more than enough of that. I want you to contemplate more, you know, more than you're doing. And they say, Ma, I'm so inspired. I need to build a hospital in your name. And she said, no. There's enough hospitals, you know. Don't worry about that. You know, I want you to contemplate. Somebody else, if the hospital needs to be built, somebody else will build it. But she says, the devotees that come to me, they need to focus on contemplation. There's plenty of worldly people who will build hospitals, but devotees should not be engaged in that. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Okay, same thing. Meaning, those who are not engaged in getting free from death, let them deal with death. Let them build the hospitals. Those who are engaged in contemplation to get past the dweller, the threshold, choose a new idea, get free of all trauma, their responsibility is contemplation, because that helps everyone else. It's the most helpful thing possible. Gives everyone three legs up. So, again, it's focusing on contemplation and knowing the difference between a genuine encounter with genuine grace and an encounter with make-believe grace. Because the belief system can make up all sorts of grace, make up all sorts of miracles, make up all sorts of encounters, all of them fake, all of them designed to lead you astray, away from the treasure, away from dropping belief, away from standing up to belief and saying, you know what, you didn't create me. You're not in charge of me. I still have the God-given right and authority to choose a new idea, and you cannot stop me from it. That's standing up to belief. And belief doesn't want you to do that. and it will do whatever it takes to distract you. It will say that God has chosen you to save the world, and will give you infinite miracles that you know, you think, wow, I'm getting all this money and people and things, and everything's perfect, I'm doing all this great stuff. Wait, I'm just playing you for a fool. The way you save the world is you save yourself first. You choose a new idea, and then you realize that new idea does save the entire world. You see a world that is trauma-free. You have the overlay. The overlay is trauma-free. There's trauma there whatsoever. And then you can tell others, this is what all you have to do. You only have to choose a new idea. Ramana said, just put on a pair of sandals, you know. That solves the problem of all the thorns and the stickers and the stones. It solves the problem of all of that. Like that. Just put on a pair of sandals instead of walking around barefoot. Same thing. Just choose a new idea and abide in that feeling of unconditional love, trauma-free. And you have been freed from all trauma. You've been freed from this terrible belief system. This insane belief system of perpetual massacre, perpetual sacrifice, sacrificial belief system. You're saved from it. You're free from it forever. Unless you want to jump back into it. But you won't want to jump back into it. Put on a pair of sandals. Choose a new idea. That's all you have to do. Let the dead take care of the dead. Let the dead build the hospitals. Let the dead build the temples and the churches and the synagogues and places of worship. Let the dead do all of that, okay? That's not your calling. If you're contemplative, that's not your calling. If you want to get past that dweller in the threshold, that is not your calling in the slightest bit. And let the dead be the entourage of some supposed return of some great savior too. Let the dead be part of that entourage. If they need to do video, if they need to do all this stuff, let them do it. It's not your concern. You really think that if Jesus returned, Jesus would be looking for people who want to build hospitals? Or is Jesus going to be looking for those who contemplatives, who can understand where the treasure is? When he tells you, this is where the treasure is, that you believe it. You say, what's Jesus going to be doing if supposedly return? Of course, looking for the contemplatives. Looking for those who can relate and understand where the treasure is and go and get that treasure. In other words, choose a new idea. Not going to be saying, okay, folks, here I am. Now we're going to build 10,000 hospitals all over the world, and we're going to clean up the planet, and we're going to do all this stuff. No. He's going to say, okay, where are the contemplatives? Those are the ones I want to. And that's what Ananda Mayama did. What did she do? She said, where are the contemplatives? And she found them. She just wandered around finding all these contemplatives and just hanging out with them. She just sit with them. She'd find them and sometimes she'd go out at night. The people, her entourage tried to keep her in a jail cell, really. And it says, Ma, you can't go anywhere unless we're there, and we have to go with you wherever you go. And they tried to control her. And they would go to sleep, and then she didn't need to sleep. She said when she went to sleep, close her eyes, she was completely wide awake at all times. And she didn't even need her eyes to see. She said when she went out in the dark, she could see everything was like lit up, like the brighter than the sun for her. And then she'd sneak out and go wandering around the banks of the Ganges and she'd find all these, ascetics there in contemplation. And she'd just, hang out with them. She'd just sit there quietly, not even saying anything. Maybe she'd, ask a couple things, a little talk sometimes, just hang out like that. Letting them know the treasure is there and contemplation is the way to find it. Letting them know that. And then when she'd reach the contemplative in a certain area of India, she'd move on to another place. It's constantly moving all over the place, reaching all these contemplatives without anyone even knowing what she was doing, really. Who knows how many were reached that way? No record of how many were reached, because she had her ways of getting around all this attempts to get her to build some hospital, support the war effort or relief mission or all this stuff. Again, nothing wrong with that, but let the dead take care of charity. Let the dead take care of the dead. Okay? That is their belief. They believe in it, so therefore they need to deal with it. But you who are dropping your belief in the universe and existence, dropping that belief, your purpose is contemplation. because you know it's all totally unreal. It's meaningless. It's nothing. It's a hypothetical scenario. It's a dream. It's imaginary. It has no reality to it whatsoever. It has no power to it whatsoever. It never will. Never will. So you have to contemplate and get clear enough so you can get past that dweller on the threshold. Belief, believing in belief 100%. You have to get past it. Otherwise, you'll remain in trauma. You'll continue to be traumatized. You see? And all the rest of this stuff, you know, those who believe in belief, they have to deal with belief then. They have to build the hospitals. They have to do the charity work. They have to do all the stuff. In India, those who take renunciation, they're not expected to do any of this stuff. It's understood that their purpose is contemplation, you know? And it's understood and it's accepted. In today, the modern society, it's not accepted. Contemplation is not accepted as a lifestyle, which is catastrophic, really catastrophic, in many, many ways. Because when catastrophe comes, there's no real way to deal with it. There's no way to put it in perspective. No way to put it in perspective. Which, it causes reinvestment, really. It causes all sorts of problems. There's no way to put it in perspective. And it just drives people, it just fuels the fires of fear and idolatry and everything bad. If you have a social class of contemplatives in the world, it's a whole different ballgame. Because people will put stuff in the right perspective. Calamity always comes to this planet. Calamity always comes to the universe. Its very purpose is to generate trauma. So, but if you have a class of contemplatives who have the right context and realize this is, you can escape this trauma. And you need to contemplate in order to do it. And you need to remain calm and stop reacting to all the stuff and stop chasing after false gods and all this stuff. The people can get through the trauma much, much easier. They have a wonderful perspective on it. And they say, well, this is awful, this is terrible, but I'm not going to stop my prayer, my contemplation. I'm going to continue on with it. Like that. So the thing is, again, the universe will always be traumatic. That's all that it is, this belief system, this idea of wanting to be prime creator that spirit chose. It plays out as trauma. Because it's an attempt to develop a trauma that can destroy reality, therefore forcing God to change reality and make spirit prime creator. That's its purpose. And it will always be traumatic. So the way that people can be helped here within this situation is to keep them from reacting to the trauma in ways that make them even more traumatized. In other words, don't be so severely traumatized by whatever happens in this world. Just realize, you know, in like India is an example, the people, you know, all this traumatic stuff's happening, and they understand, you know, this is the dance of Maya. This is what happens here. But let me not overreact to it. Let me not tear my hair out and say I've got to invent a trillion different pharmaceuticals to try and prevent any sort of trauma or suffering. You know, we got to heal everything. We got to save the world. We got to make everything better and great and all this kind of stuff, knowing full well that they're just wasting time, because there's no way to get free of trauma in existence. No way. So they don't even try. Instead, they spend their time contemplating, which smooths out the trauma to a certain extent, and enables one then to eventually get to the point where they're able to choose a new idea and they're free of it. That's the only way to get free of it. So it's a win-win, actually. But we don't have that anymore. We don't have a class of contemplatives, certainly in the West, around the world. It is vanishing, really. The respect towards a class of contemplatives is vanishing. The appreciation, the understanding of the help and the importance is vanishing. And so when catastrophes and problems come, and people will go freak out. They'll freak out. They'll be bewildered. They'll be stunned. They'll be shocked. They say, I can't believe this is happening, you know? There's all sorts of problems coming in the world. You know, I've warned people about it. And you need to, it's better to warn a year in advance than a year too late, you know? What good is a warning a year too late? This is no good at all. The sustainable debt we have is impossible, you know? It's going to collapse. It's a pyramid scheme. is going to collapse. At some point, a pyramid scheme gets exponentially bad suddenly. It's exponential. And so it seems like things are okay, and then suddenly, oh my gosh, and then boom. You know, we've already had that, you know, mini pyramid scheme back there in New York, everything seemed fine. They got through, and then suddenly, oh my gosh, kaboom, the whole thing just collapsed. The civilization, the way things are in the world now, it's all a pyramid scheme. It's all a pyramid scheme right now. That is true. I've been saying that and saying that and saying that. I've known that my whole life is going to collapse. It's a pyramid scheme. Not just our civilization, the ecosystems, everything that's going on is a pyramid scheme. It's reaching, it's going to peak, exponentially peak, and then kaboom. Now, people, you know, if they don't understand the nature, have done no contemplation, no understanding of the nature of the universe, they don't understand it's traumatic, that it's merciless, that it's a death factory, that everything has led to the slaughter here. If they don't understand that, they're going to freak out, and their mental state, you know, is going to get unhinged, totally unhinged. That is not good. You should be able to look at all the trauma and everything that happens and just say, well, of course, what do you expect here? What else do you expect? Of course that's going to happen. We knew it was going to happen. We were warned. We saw it. Okay. Now back to our contemplation. You know, you don't tear your hair out. You don't, shriek. You don't go crazy. You don't become unhinged. Everything is born, only born to die. Everything the universe gives you, it only gives you so it can take it away from you. Keep generating the sense of loss, so that the belief in loss can become real at some point. That's the hope, the false hope. So of course the universe is terrible. Of course it's terrible. But if you don't realize that, you expect everything to work out great, and it doesn't. You know, you come unhinged, and then you can't really contemplate. When you're unhinged, you go on side trips, severe side trips. You get all fragmented, you know, and you may fragment into many, many, many different lives. Many, many different lives, trying to somehow deal with this, you know, horrible panic that you're feeling and all this stuff. Whereas if you contemplate, you just say, no, this is exactly, you know, the way the universe is. I know I can escape the universe by choosing a new idea. And the way I do that is I have to get past the door on the threshold. The way I do that is through contemplation and clarification. Understanding it's 100% futile. One second here. I'm getting some. Okay, there you go. Someone said, nah, problems, 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 problems. Can you fix all these problems? Well, okay. I said, okay. But contemplation comes first. Contemplation comes first. You have to continue on, you know? You don't just drop everything. If someone says, oh, you need to fix this stuff, you don't just drop everything immediately and do what the world wants you to do. You know, the dead, let the dead worry about the dead. Let those who are continuing with death, let them worry about it. It's not our concern, you know? It's not our concern. But sometimes you do have to fix stuff. Just the way the world is, everything breaks here, everything falls apart, it's ridiculous. And that gets, you know, pushed down on certain people. They're supposed to fix everything. And everybody says, oh, you're so clever. No, you're just desperate. You got no choice, you have to fix it. I'm no good at fixing stuff. I'm terrible at it. But it's just, you got no choice. You got to try to work it, keep working on it until you do it. There's no, yeah, of course, those who don't want to fix stuff will flatter others and say, oh my gosh, I could never have done that. You're so smart. You're so clever. How did you do that? You know, total manipulation. They just want you to fix it and make you think that you got some special ability that they don't have. No, you just have to put in the time and effort and desperation and figure out a way somehow to do it. That's all. But the number one thing, again, is contemplation. And when you get interrupted, you go right back. So we've had a couple interruptions here. You go right back to it. Right back to it. Getting past that dweller on the threshold, that's all important. Not freaking out when stuff happens, that's all important. My attitude when stuff happens is just, yeah, you know, well, no real reaction to it. Within, you know, I may, you know, give a reaction, you know, but what I'm feeling, no reaction really. Like, even when terrible natural disasters happen, you know, really there's no, very little reaction. Like, it's, I saw that coming. I know it was going to happen. And maybe I tried to warn people, but it didn't work. Or it's tragic, yes, it's terrible tragic, but that's how the universe is. That's what the universe is. It is what it is. Freaking out about it isn't going to change it. You know, when people freak out, they think, oh my gosh, I got to change this. I got to find a way to change it. I got to project myself into, you know, 10 more lives and work on changing it. Or I got to make people feel better by, you know, some way. Instead of seeing it, this is what it is. This is existence. This is the universe. The universe has no mercy. None. Zero. And yet it tries to tell us how merciful it is. It's not merciful. God's grace is merciful. Contemplation is merciful. Choosing a new idea is merciful. That's where the mercy can be found, but not within the workings of nature or the universe. No way. It gives only to take away. Whatever it gives is only giving in order to take it away. So it may seem merciful, but then it'll take that mercy away. Whereas by choosing a new idea, unconditional love is never taken away. It doesn't get taken away. There's no power taking it away. It's not giving in order to take away, which is another reason why we're afraid of it. We think, oh, unconditional love is so wonderful, but it's so wonderful I can't bear to have it taken away. And we think that whatever we get, our experience has been, whatever we get gets taken away. So we refuse to experience unconditional love because it's too wonderful, and if it ever got taken away, we couldn't stand it. But it won't get taken away. That's the fact. It will not get taken away. Because it arises from the idea of not trying to change reality. Not trying to change reality. Not trying to be prime creator. Not trying to change reality. Not trying to change anything. Accepting everything as it is. Accepting the isness of reality. So that effect of that idea just is. And there's nothing, no dynamic that can take that away. Cannot. It overlays everything and just is that overlay. And cannot be taken away. Cannot be taken away, except by your own. If you want to choose to go back to trying to be prime creator, then you can deprive yourself of it that way, but you won't do that. You won't do that. There's no power, no dynamic within it that takes it away. None, zero. So when we get it, we can rest assured it's going to stay with us. It will stay with us. But we don't trust that. We don't believe it. See, we don't believe it. We can't believe it. It's literally unbelievable. Because nothing in belief is that way at all. That's why Jesus said, peace beyond understanding. It could say, peace beyond belief. Or peace that is unbelievable. Unconditional love is unbelievable. Nothing in belief can believe that. It cannot believe it. Cannot. That's why it won't search. You say, no, you know, this is unbelievable. Where do you find that? And it can't believe that it can be found, you know, here. Can't believe it. No. It's got to be somewhere in belief, but and then it must change. Also, belief will say it must change. It can't be stable. There's nothing stable in belief. Nothing. Belief is inherently unstable. So it will insist that unconditional love cannot last. Well, still, you'll still want to find it, because what you are, you'll say, wait a minute, that looks stable to me, you know. Belief won't believe it, though. Belief will say it's unbelievable. And then you have to say, well, yeah, it is unbelievable, because it's real, and belief is not real. It's belief that is unbelievable. It's the goals of belief that are unbelievable, or that are impossible, not even unbelievable, impossible. They're believable, but impossible. Okay, use reality as your foundation, your cornerstone, not belief. And in these times, it's super important to let this somehow seep in. Again, belief won't believe it. Belief doesn't really believe anything that's being said here. To believe reality is unbelievable. Totally unbelievable. Not possible. It's unbelievable. Always will be. Okay, belief will look at reality and say, it's unbelievable. It's unreal. It's hypothetical. Belief believes that reality is hypothetical. It's got the things completely backwards and upside down. Believes that it's reality, that's the hypothetical, that's the unbelievable, that can never be true, that it's really just a imaginary desire of something, wishful thinking. That's what belief believes. And we'll always believe it. We'll always believe. Belief will always believe in belief. Belief will always be belief. That's what it is. You can't transform belief into something else. There's no power of transformation in reality, none. And only the powers that reality creates are powers. There are no other powers. Magic is belief. The powers that belief believe in are just magic, which are nothing. They're just relativistic type of temporary constructs, is all they really are. They're nothing. So the universe will continue to be the way that it is, which means trauma, of course. Don't you know, sit back and say, ah, no, we're going to find some way, everything's going to be great. Well, you know, tell that to the Japanese up in Fukushima, and, you know, tell it to them, everything's just going to be fine. They just woke up one morning and everything was exactly the same as always been, going about their business like, hey, the world's a really great place, you know. I mean, stuff happens in the universe. Stuff is always happening in the universe. Trauma is always happening in the universe. Always. You get up one day, think everything's fine, boom, trauma. Trauma will find you out, will seek you out. The only way to escape it is to escape trauma itself. Choose an idea in which there is no trauma, that generates no trauma whatsoever. That's the only way. It's the only way. Everything else is a side trip. Everything else is a side trip. And there's all sorts of people on all sorts of side trips. The whole world, the whole universe is on a side trip. And all they do is say, hey, my side trip is cooler than yours. goes on. Is my side trip is more interesting than your side trip. Or my side trip is more sophisticated than yours. Or my side trip is more spiritual than your side trip. You know, whatever. My side trip's more effective than yours, you know. Everyone's comparing to their side trips. When you're contemplating, you're not comparing your contemplation to someone else's contemplation. You're too busy just contemplating. Forget it. I'm not interested in anyone else's contemplation, what they're doing, how well they're doing it. Forget it. Let the finishers deal with that, you know. Your job is just do the best you can. And not get caught up in these side trips and thinking, gee, I need a side trip too, because these people, wow, they got this really intricate, you know, heavy-duty side trip. And they've got all these degrees, and they're heads of this and that, and, you know, they got all these people listening to, wow, it's an interesting side trip. So, well, I don't have one, I need a side trip. What kind of side trip can I get that is good as that one, you know? And then you waste your time doing that. Forget about side trips. There's nothing. They're nothing. Waste of time. It's only waste of time. How cool is it wasting time when you know that just makes the trauma worse for you? It just keeps you enslaved to trauma for even longer. and your reaction to trauma will be even worse. How cool is that? You know, when you get all this peer pressure, which you get in life, you know, ask yourself, how they're only pressuring you into trauma. How cool is it to be traumatized more and more and more and more? How cool is that? Is that really cool? Is that great? Is that wonderful? No, it's terrible. Nobody really wants that. But you know, everybody wants to kind of act like, yeah. I'm okay with trauma. I'm not, you know, I'm down with a little bit of it. You know, I can handle some of it. You know, we try to be good sports. I'm a good sport about it, that kind of stuff. But no, not a good sport about it. Don't be a good sport about trauma. Just say, you know what, I'm gonna get free of all of this, so I'm not gonna pay any attention to it. Whatever, you know, that's yesterday's. That's nothing. That's gonna be gone. I'm gonna get free of it, so I don't need to know anything about trauma. I don't need to react to it. I don't need to deal with it. I don't forget it. Just it's. I'm gonna choose a new idea, and trauma is just a dream. It's just a dream. It is. All it is a dream. A dream of trauma. I'm going to awaken from that dream. So don't get so interested in trauma. Specific stuff, you know, all the stuff that world's happening. Oh my gosh, you go to, what are these gossip sites, you know, and it's just like full of like everybody's trauma. the celebrity, you know, celebrity trauma. Oh my gosh, I gotta find out what's happening. Oh my gosh, they're so traumatized. Oh, terrible, you know. Makes people feel better. Like, oh, look at these celebrities. They're getting so traumatized. So, you know, my life of trauma is, you know, they're no better than me or something, whatever. Forget about it. Don't even focus on trauma. Of course it's there. Of course it's there. It's like the air we breathe. That's all existence is. That's its sole purpose, is to develop trauma to a point where it becomes real. So of course it's constantly working on that. Of course, that's all that it is. That's all that it does. That is what it is. It is what it is, and that's what it is. So just don't even give it any significance or importance. Just from a pragmatic, functional standpoint, give it whatever you need to function, but don't give it any more significance or time or effort or thought or anything like that. Don't worry about trying to, you know, heal the trauma or whatever. No. Get free of it. By choosing a new idea, get free of it. Get free of it. Because that's what you really want. You want to be free of trauma. And you can, very simply and easily. But you do have to get past that dweller on the threshold. The belief, believing in belief 100%. Okay, and it's doable. I am very convinced it is doable. Because I had that internal experience of doing it. And maybe like a time lapse from that to actually externalizing it somehow. I don't know. But it is doable. It is doable. You can face the dweller and do the right thing and say, okay, I'm going to choose a new idea. I don't care. You know, your death stare is not going to prevent me from choosing a new idea. Your 100% true believerness in belief is not going to prevent me from choosing a new idea. So just do it. That is absolutely doable. No question about it. All the gurus, my gurus and teachers have said it's absolutely doable. No question about it. You can do it. All of us can do it. And they showed that they had done it. And that the dweller on the threshold did not intimidate them even the slightest bit. And they said, you can do it. So I know that it's true. I believe them. And then I've seen internally that it's possible too. So don't give up your contemplation, because every bit of contemplation you do, you get closer to finally doing that, standing up to that ultimate bully. The ultimate bully. Belief is the ultimate bully. It's the ultimate bully. There's nothing else comes close. And we live in a bully culture now, don't we? From all sides. Bullies everywhere. That shows the strength of belief, the belief in belief is becoming so strong now, it's giving rise to all these bullies. Trying to bully everyone, you know, into continuing on with belief. But the ultimate bully is belief itself. And you can stand up to it. You're greater than belief. Infinitely greater. Totally greater. It's like one standing up to zero. See? How much greater is one than zero? You can't even measure it. can't even measure it. That's like saying, how much greater is life than death? Meaning than the meaningless. Endlessness. How much greater is endlessness to time? How much? Can you measure it? No, it's immeasurable. Because endlessness never ends. Okay, so there's no way to measure how much greater it is. One is infinitely, immeasurably greater than zero. Okay, it's not just a little bit. It's immeasurably greater than zero. Because zero, there's nothing there to measure. So, you know, if you want to talk about measurement, it's infinitely, immeasurably greater. Which then makes measurement a moot point, right? And if you drop even measurement, you can drop even measurement at that point. All right. Covered a lot of ground here. Very important to share this information. Get this information circulating. Get it out there. Let people realize there are options. And the world is traumatic, but there are options to be able to get through the trauma without becoming unhinged and actually get to a place where we're able to stand up to the ultimate bully and free ourselves from all trauma forever. It's absolutely doable, and we can use these times to motivate us to do this. And it's very important that we do that, because the trauma that is coming is very intense. It's the kind that gets people unhinged, the world unhinged, the whole world becoming unhinged, which will only cause a reinvestment in belief, which is not what we want. Not what we want. So stick with it. Stay with it. Stay with it, and the truth will stay with you. All right, very great. That's it for this video.